Good morning. My name is Ahmed Abdalrazag. I am a medical doctor who worked with Doctors Without Borders. In a refugee camp in Tunisia, 2011. I'm also a refugee who has experienced many of the hardships to be discussed from in the Forced From Home exhibit. Imagine a 7-year-old boy. He hears bombing and runs down to the basement because it is the safest place. The place where he is least likely to be hit by bombs. At 7, he can smell death. His tiny knee trembling from the loud, terrifying missile. He hears the sound of the breaking glass and windows. How many of you can imagine an old lady in her mid-60s leaning forward on her cane, fleeing the echo of the bombardment behind her? I don't care if you leave me alone here. It's okay if I die, she said to her grandsons, who start to run. With every stride they take, she gets farther away. That lady was my grandmother, who died last year at age of 90, and she survived the Gulf War. That kid was me, using the basement as a shelter. Years later, in medical school, I learned that I had post-traumatic disorder. Recently, I saw some of the same imagery from childhood on the news through the photos of Omran Deknish, the little boy in the ambulance in Syria. Bewildered, wiping the blood from his face after his house was bombed. I was shocked, thrown back into the past. There are similar incidents still taking place as I speak to you today. This is one of the reasons I'm here. I want to share my story to convey some of the reality of the refugees and those fleeing conflict zone are going through. In Iraq, 1998, I remember my mom imploring my dad, I want to leave this place. I don't want my kids to carry arms or be trained by this monster. I'm tired of hiding them every night. So we fled from Iraq to Jordan, from Jordan to Libya, from Libya to Tunis. In Libya, I spent almost a decade of my life. The political situation in Libya started to change drastically in 2011. One night, we heard the clattering and rattling at the front door. Suddenly, we started to hear strong booming, like someone trying to break in. I opened the door. My mom and sister start into hysterical yelling. It was pro-Gaddafi men. They were yelling in my face, but they were looking for another man. We knew it was a time to flee again. We moved to Tunisia, where the UN was accepting refugees. There, I lived in Shusha refugee camp. That vast desert where I had to wait in very long lines to get my weekly shower and my daily meals. While there, I saw the MSF needed a physician, so I applied. I was hired and began treating refugees while I was a refugee. In the camp, we wear different clothes and had different beliefs, yet we suffer from the same hunger and pain. One of my patients, he was 15 years old, had lost his sight due to an infection in his cornea. Simple surgery would restore his perfect vision. But when you are a refugee, you wait for years. Even for simple surgery, even if you are a kid or a child. we were finally approved to be resettled in the U.S. We are still considered lucky because our resettlement took less than 5 years. A refugee can be anyone. A refugee is not constrained by color or race. They can be artists, dancers, doctors, philosophers, humans with ambitions and dreams. I have shared my story today in hope that it will give people a better understanding of the images they see on the news. But my story is just one of more than 65 million. Most of this story will remain untold. This year, more than 3,000 people died while trying to reach the safety of Europe's shores. Many more remain missing. Each person leaves behind loved ones, ambitions, and dreams. I tell my story on behalf of them because I am one of the lucky ones. Thank you. Now you will hear from Nisha.